Hello and welcome. You're watching To The Point. In a little while from now, and perhaps in just 10 minutes and not much more, Sushma Swaraj will begin her address to the United Nations General Assembly. This is a much-awaited speech because it's widely expected that she will respond in strong terms to Nawaz Sharif's speech of last week. So in the next few minutes as we await her speech, the key questions I want to ask are, what is she likely to say? And perhaps even more importantly, is a hard response to Nawaz Sharif the best strategy? My guests are India's former Foreign Secretary Kamal Sibal, former media advisor to Dr. Manmohan Singh Sanjay Baru, the Strategic Affairs Editor of the Indian Express Praveen Swamy, and the Strategic Affairs Editor of the Business Standard Ajay Shukla. Sanjay Baru, we've got 5 or 6 minutes, I'm told, before Mrs. Swaraj speaks. She is listed as the third person for the day, and the second speaker, the Foreign Minister of Bahrain, is presently speaking. So let me use these 10 minutes that we have to actually ask a pretty radical question. When Mrs. Swaraj stands up, it will be India's second response and riposte to Nawaz Sharif. The first, as you remember, happened on that day itself. Are we playing Pakistan's game by constantly responding to Nawaz Sharif? Could we run the risk of internationalizing Kashmir? Because after all, when Nawaz spoke, the United Nations General Assembly chamber was virtually empty. No one other than India and Pakistan paid much heed to what he had to say. So having responded once, do we need to invest another 20 minutes at the level of our foreign minister to respond again? Could that not end up playing Nawaz and Pakistan's game of internationalizing Kashmir?
Well, I don't worry about internationalizing Kashmir because I don't think anybody is interested in getting into Kashmir. But I certainly agree with you that the focus of the Indian foreign minister's address to the UNGA should not be Nawaz Sharif. The focus should be India's concerns about a large range of international issues. We are an aspiring power for the UN Security Council membership. Once a year, the foreign minister or the prime minister of the country addresses the UNGA, and there are a large number of issues that can and should be taken up. Certainly, there has to be some response. There's, as you correctly said, there's already been a response to Nawaz Sharif by a junior diplomat. I think, you know, that was a very apt way of responding. And some of the substantial issues raised by Nawaz Sharif should be addressed in passing. But I don't think the focus of the foreign minister's speech should in fact be a response. I think the focus should be India's concerns about the larger issues of development globally, UN reform, climate change, terrorism globally. I mean, there are a large number of issues the UN system is grappling with. And therefore, I would actually argue that any references to Nawaz Sharif or to Pakistan should be in passing rather than the main focus of her address.
Let me bring in Kamal Sibal on that. Kamal Sibal, you've been Foreign Secretary. You've taken these decisions when you were head of the Foreign Service. When Mrs. Swaraj stands up, and I'm told it will happen sometime in the next 5 minutes, maybe 10, this will be India's second response to Nawaz Sharif. The first happened literally minutes after he finished. And the question I ask Sanjay Baru is, do we need to keep responding to Nawaz? Are we not playing Pakistan's game of internationalizing Kashmir each time we stand up and respond to him? And clearly, the India-Pakistan problem is one that bores the United Nations to tears. Nawaz spoke virtually to an empty house. If Mrs. Swaraj tries to repeat another response, she might end up doing the same. And Sanjay says that clearly, responding to Nawaz must not be the focus. She should do it in passing and move on to other issues of greater substance. As a former foreign secretary, do you agree or do you disagree?
No, I broadly agree with him, except that, you know, there is something called the right of reply. Now, if we had not exercised it immediately after Nawaz Sharif's speech, then the entire media reporting would have been focused on what Nawaz Sharif said. And our case and our response would have gone unnoticed, and we would have, I think, suffered a media setback. So it was necessary to give the right of reply, which is part of how the modalities of this kind of a conference work. At the foreign affairs minister level, there are two things. One is that Prime Minister Modi himself, in his speech in Kerala, clearly outlined the scope of the Indian reaction. And I don't think the foreign minister can say anything different or outside this framework. And therefore, to that extent, her speech becomes much less important for the Indian audience in terms of what she has to say in response to Nawaz Sharif. And therefore, I'm sure she's going to have a much broader sweep in her speech, which should be the case, and deal with the various issues in front of the international community. But she has to address the issue of terrorism, and on some salient points which Nawaz Sharif made, she has to respond at her level. Because in the right of reply, it was a very aggressive response, very aggressive response. But at her level, it has to be more modulated, more balanced, more, and much more acceptable in terms of language and quality.
I'll come, Ajay Shukla, to questions to do with the content and the specific points that Mrs. Swaraj may or may not make in a moment's time. But first, let me point this out to you. There's no doubt enormous interest, as every single television channel has shown today in the run-up to Mrs. Swaraj's speech. We're all watching it as if it was some sort of gladiatorial match that's going to happen on our screens. And I imagine there will be perhaps something like similar interest in Pakistan. But what about at the UN itself? I mean, how does the UN General Assembly respond to this aggressive ding-dong that goes on every year between India and Pakistan? When Nawaz spoke, it was pretty close to an empty chamber that he addressed. Might Mrs. Swaraj find the same thing? And might she find that if she goes into the India-Pakistan problem in great depth and detail, she might empty the chamber further?
That's probably right. When the foreign ministry spokesperson said that the India and the world are waiting to listen to what Mrs. Swaraj has to say, I think he may have been overstating the case. India is certainly waiting to see what Sushma Swaraj has to say. But in the global arena, I think there is a high degree of fatigue at, you know, India and Pakistan's annual jousting in the UN General Assembly chamber. So to that extent, she will have to walk this balancing act between giving a response, giving an adequate response to Pakistan, but at the same time not making it seem like India's locked into this relationship with Pakistan. And that's all that the world is going to hear from India or Pakistan about. But remember, Karan, we are coming off an Indo-Pak crisis stemming from the Uri attack, where Prime Minister Modi has said essentially that he will avenge the martyrs of Uri by isolating Pakistan in the international arena. So Mrs. Swaraj cannot also just mention terrorism in passing. She has to really launch a full frontal attack on Pakistan today, if only because the Prime Minister has committed to the country that we're going to do so. So I think that the way it's probably going to play out is Mrs. Swaraj will talk about terrorism in general as a problem that afflicts the world, and then zero in on Pakistan as the epicenter of global terrorism, and in the memorable words of the right of reply, the Ivy League of terrorism where it takes place. At the same time, she'll probably mention in passing that, you know, all the allegations that Pakistan raised on Kashmir, they're a part of Pakistan's export of terror. It's all Pakistan-based terror that is taking place in Kashmir, and India's only responding. So I think that's how it's going to play out today.
Sanjay Baru, one of the things I noticed about Nawaz Sharif's speech last week is that he spent most of his time when he was addressing the Kashmir issue talking about the unrest in the valley that's gone on for pretty close to 80 days. And he had some stinging things to say. But he said not a word about Uri. Might Mrs. Swaraj do the opposite, concentrate on terror, Uri, Pakistan's involvement, but not respond to what Nawaz Sharif said about the trouble in the valley that's lasted for nearly 80 days?
You know, Karan, when the Prime Minister of Pakistan stands in the UN General Assembly, he can only think about India. You know, he's obsessed about India. The world around him is really defined by India's rise. While when the Foreign Minister of India stands in the UN General Assembly, there are several issues. Terrorism is certainly one of them, and the problem from Pakistan is certainly one of them. But it's not the only issue for the Foreign Minister of India to be addressing to the UN General Assembly. Remember, we seek to be members of the UN Security Council. We have to have views about international security. We have to have views about what's happening in the Middle East, about South China Sea, about climate change, you know, about world nuclear proliferation. There are a large number of issues that the Indian Foreign Minister should be talking about.
So you would say, Sanjay Baru, that if more than 5 minutes out of 20 are spent on this joint subject of Kashmir and terror, she will have overdone it?
Absolutely. 5 minutes is actually far too much. Probably 3-4 minutes. That's it.
I'm told by my producer that Mrs. Swaraj is about to start. There are probably just a couple of minutes left. Let me ask you, Kamal Sebal, one quick question, because I don't think we have time for anything more, and please give me a short answer. Given that this is a speech to the UN General Assembly, do you think Mrs. Swaraj will speak in Hindi, or would she be better advised to speak in English? And I'm afraid she's about to start speaking, so you can't answer. She'll answer that question herself. We're going straight to the UN, where Mrs. Swaraj will be starting to speak literally in the next 10
Good.
Seconds.
Good.
Namaskar.
Good morning. Honorable President.
श्री पीटर थॉमसन जी को इस 71वें अधिवेशन की अध्यक्षता करने के लिए चुने जाने पर बधाई देती और इसके साथ ही श्री बान की मून जी जो संयुक्त राष्ट्र संघ के महासचिव के तौर पर जिन्होंने सेवाएं की हैं उनको धन्यवाद देती हूं अध्यक्ष जी एक वर्ष पहले मैंने इसी पवित्र मंच से अंतर्राष्ट्रीय समुदाय के सदस्यों को संबोधित किया था तब से लेकर आज तक विश्व में बहुत परिवर्तन हुआ है कुछ अच्छा कुछ बुरा और कुछ बहुत चिंता देने वाला ये एक मंच है जहां हम तमाम घटनाक्रमों पर चर्चा करते हैं आज भी करेंगे लेकिन चर्चा करते समय ये जरूर देखेंगे कि समीक्षा उन कामों की भी हो जो हमने किए हैं और समीक्षा उन कामों की भी हो जो हम नहीं कर पाए हैं अध्यक्ष जी इस गरिमामय महासभा में अनेक मुद्दों पर चर्चा हुई है जैसे एएमआर के लिए नए टीकों को साझा करना सस्ती दवाइयों की उपलब्धता को सुनिश्चित करना प्राकृतिक आपदाओं के जोखिम को कम करने के लिए सैन्य ढांचे को लागू करना मानव संसाधनों को मुक्त और सुरक्षित आवागमन सुनिश्चित करना और यूएन पीस कीपिंग फोर्स में सैनिक भेजने वाले देशों के साथ विचार विमर्श करना समय के अभाव के कारण मैं इन मुद्दों को नहीं दोहराना चाहूंगी लेकिन कुछ ऐसे मुद्दों का उल्लेख जरूर करना चाहूंगी जो अंतर्राष्ट्रीय समुदाय के लिए अत्यंत महत्वपूर्ण है अध्यक्ष जी आज हमारे सामने सबसे बड़ी चुनौती है विश्व के कोने कोने में फैली हुई गरीबी को मिटाना और ये सुनिश्चित करना कि हम सभी जरूरतमंद लोगों तक समृद्धि पहुंचा सकें हमें यह भी सुनिश्चित करना है कि स्त्रियों और पुरुषों के बीच लैंगिक समानता हो और महिलाओं को सुरक्षा मिले हम विश्व शांति के लिए कार्य करना है क्योंकि शांति के बिना समृद्धि नहीं आ सकती श्री पीटर थॉमसन इसलिए अभिनंदन के पात्र हैं क्योंकि उन्होंने इन्हीं चुनौतियों के महत्व को समझते हुए इस महासभा के लिए सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स यानी टिकाऊ विकास के लक्ष्य को सबसे उच्च
प्राथमिकता दी
2030 तक का एजेंडा लेकिन मुझे आपको कहते हुए खुशी है कि मात्र 2 साल में ही इन 17 में से अधिकतर लक्ष्यों को भारत सरकार ने अपने राष्ट्रीय कार्यक्रमों में शामिल कर लिया सैनिटेशन यानी स्वच्छता उसके अंतर्गत हमने स्वच्छ भारत अभियान छेड़ा है जिसके अंतर्गत 2 लाख विद्यालयों में 4 लाख शौचालय बनकर तैयार हो गए हैं और काम कर रहे हैं इसी तरह जेंडर इक्वालिटी उसके नीचे बेटी बचाओ बेटी पढ़ाओ एक देशव्यापी अभियान बन गया है और महिलाओं ने इसका बीड़ा अपने सर पर उठाया है हमारे यहाँ लाखों लाख जनप्रतिनिधि महिलाएं चुनकर आई हुई हैं वो स्वयं इस अभियान को आगे बढ़ा रही हैं
मेक इन इंडिया
जिसका आह्वान प्रधानमंत्री जी ने किया है उसके कारण विदेशी पूंजी निवेश भी आ रहा है और हमारे अपने बच्चों को रोजगार भी मिल रहा है एक और बड़ी योजना गरीबों के लिए जनधन योजना ये विश्व की सबसे बड़ी वित्तीय समावेशी योजना है इसके अंतर्गत 25 करोड़ से ज्यादा गरीब लोगों के बैंक खाते खोले गए.
डिजिटल इंडिया बहुत तेजी से अपने पैर पसार रहा है. डिजिटल इंडिया
भारतीय युवाओं को कौशल युक्त बनाने के लिए अनेकानेक प्रशिक्षण कार्यक्रम चल रहे हैं, जिनसे हमारे युवा अपनी क्षमताओं का समुचित विकास कर सकते हैं. इस तरह की पहलों से भारत की नए आयाम जुड़े हैं और आज आर्थिक मंदी के दौर में भी भारत विश्व की बड़ी अर्थव्यवस्थाओं में सबसे तेजी से विकास करने वाली अर्थव्यवस्था बन गया है.
एट अ टाइम ऑफ स्लो ग्लोबल ग्रोथ.
अध्यक्ष जी, हम सब जानते हैं कि मानवता का 1/6 हिस्सा भारत में है. इसलिए यदि भारत में सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स ये टिकाऊ विकास लक्ष्य सफल होंगे, तभी विश्व में सफल हो सकते हैं. हम एजेंडा 2030 को पूरे मनोयोग से लागू करने के लिए कमिटेड. हमने तय किया है कि संसद के हर सत्र में एक दिन केवल SDGs पर हम चर्चा किया करेंगे, ताकि इनकी प्रगति पर सतत निगरानी रखी जा सके. और मुझे विश्वास है कि इससे बहुत ही के लिए अपने अपने सामर्थ्य के अनुसार काम कर रहे हैं. लेकिन मैं ये कहना चाहूंगी कि उन्हें अंतर्राष्ट्रीय सहयोग भी मिलता रहेगा तो वो भी इसमें और ज्यादा सफलता प्राप्त करेंगे. अध्यक्ष जी, मैं दूसरा विषय ले रही हूँ जलवायु परिवर्तन का. जलवायु परिवर्तन एक और ऐसा मुद्दा है जो हमारे सामने एक गंभीर चुनौती बनकर खड़ा है. प्रकृति के पास संपदा तो अपार है, लेकिन उतनी ही जितनी वो मनुष्य की जरूरत को पूरा कर सके, इतनी नहीं कि वो उसके लालच का पेट भर सके, क्योंकि लोभ की तो कोई सीमा नहीं होती. इसीलिए हमारे यहाँ हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने एक सिद्धांत दिया है, क्लाइमेट जस्टिस, जलवायु न्याय. और हम ये मानते हैं कि अगर प्रकृति के साथ हम न्याय करें तो वो हमारे और हमारी भावी पीढ़ियों के साथ न्याय करेगी, लेकिन यदि हम उसका अंधाधुंध दोहन करेंगे तो वो क्रोधित हो जाएगी और अपना रौद्र रूप दिखाएगी. हम देख रहे हैं दुनिया में कई जगहों पर प्रकृति अप्राकृतिक हो उठी है. कहीं भयंकर वर्षा, कहीं घनघोर गर्मी, कहीं झंझावात, कहीं सुनामी, कहीं बादलों का फटना. ये समय का तकाजा है कि अब हम असीमित खपत पर रोक लगाएं और अपनी जीवन शैली को पर्यावरण के अनुकूल बनाएं. योग इसका एक बड़ा माध्यम बन सकता है. योग भारत का वो प्राचीन ज्ञान है जो एक टिकाऊ जीवन शैली का प्रतीक है. पिछले 2 वर्षों से अंतर्राष्ट्रीय योग दिवस के लिए जो अपार समर्थन आप सबसे मिल रहा है, मैं आज इस मंच से आप सबके प्रति आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ. अध्यक्ष जी, पेरिस समझौते में कॉमन बट डिफ्रेंशिएटेड रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज विद रिस्पेक्टिव कैपेसिटीज के सिद्धांत को स्वीकारा गया है, जिसका अर्थ है कि जिम्मेदारी तो सबकी सांझी है लेकिन देनदारी सबकी अलग अलग. इसलिए ये बेहद जरूरी है कि विकसित देश अपनी जिम्मेदारियों का निर्वहन करते हुए सभी की भलाई के लिए तकनीक भी दें और धनराशि भी, तभी ये कार्यक्रम सफल होगा. हमने अपने देश में बहुत महत्वाकांक्षी योजना बनाई है, जिसमें हमने वर्ष 2030 तक 40% ऊर्जा नॉन फॉसिल फ्यूल से बनाने का लक्ष्य रखा है. इसके लिए हमें एक निश्चित वातावरण की आवश्यकता होगी, क्योंकि बाहर से पूंजी निवेश करने वालों को वातावरण की निश्चिंतता चाहिए और हम इस प्रयास में लगे हुए हैं. इसके अलावा इंटरनेशनल सोलर अलायंस का गठन भी हमारी एक अभिनव पहल है, जिससे सौर तकनीक सभी को उपलब्ध हो सकेगी. मैं इस मंच से ये विश्वास दिलाती हूँ कि जलवायु परिवर्तन की दिशा में भारत एक अग्रणी भूमिका निभाएगा. और मुझे आपको खुशी है ये बताते हुए कि हमने निर्णय किया है कि पेरिस समझौते के लिए भारत अपना इंस्ट्रूमेंट ऑफ रेटिफिकेशन 2 अक्टूबर को जमा करा देगा. और ये स्थिति हमने सोच समझ कर चुनी है, क्योंकि 2 अक्टूबर गांधी जी का जन्म दिवस है, जिनका संपूर्ण जीवन प्रकृति के संरक्षण को ही समर्पित रहा. अध्यक्ष जी, अब मैं एक ऐसे विषय पर बोलने जा रही हूँ जिस पर इस सभा में बैठा हर व्यक्ति चिंतित है और चिंतित ही नहीं सोचने पर मजबूर है. इसी महीने इस शहर में हुए 9/11 आतंकी हमले की 15वीं वर्षगांठ थी. पिछले 15 दिनों में इसी शहर में एक और आतंकी हमले में मासूमों को मारने की कोशिश की गई थी. हम इस शहर के दर्द को समझते हैं. हम पर भी उरी में इन्हीं आतंकी ताकतों ने हमला किया था। विश्व इस अभिशाप से बहुत समय से जूझ रहा है, लेकिन आतंकवाद का शिकार हुए मासूमों के खून और आंसुओं के बावजूद इस वर्ष काबुल, ढाका, इस्तांबुल, मागादिशु, ब्रसेल्स, बैंकॉक, पेरिस, पठानकोट और उरी में हुए आतंकवादी हमले और सीरिया और इराक में रोजमर्रा की बर्बर त्रासदियां हमें ये याद दिलाती हैं कि हम इसे रोकने में सफल नहीं हो रहे। अध्यक्ष जी, यहाँ बैठे सब लोगों को पहले तो एक बार ये स्वीकारना होगा, यदि हम आतंकवाद से लड़ना चाहते हैं, कि आतंकवाद मानवाधिकारों का सबसे बड़ा उल्लंघन है। सबसे पहले हम इसे स्वीकारें, आतंकवाद मानवाधिकारों का सबसे बड़ा उल्लंघन है, क्योंकि वो निर्दोष लोगों को निशाना बनाता है, बेगुनाहों को मारता है। वो किसी व्यक्ति या देश का नहीं बल्कि मानवता का अपराधी है। और उसके बाद देखना होगा कि इन आतंकवादियों को पनाह देने वाले कौन कौन है। आतंकवादियों का न तो कोई अपना बैंक है, न हथियारों की फैक्ट्रियां, तो कहां से उन्हें धन मिलता है? कौन इन्हें हथियार देता है? कौन इन्हें सहारा देता है? कौन इन्हें संरक्षण देता है? ऐसे ही सवाल इसी मंच से अफगानिस्तान ने भी कुछ दिन पहले उठाए थे। अध्यक्ष जी, इतिहास गवाह है कि जिस किसी ने भी हिंसक विचारधारा के बीज बोए हैं, उसका कड़वा फल उसे खाने को मिला है। ये छोटे छोटे आतंकवादी समूह जो छिटपुट काम कर रहे थे, आज इन समूहों ने मिलकर एक राक्षस का रूप धारण कर लिया, जिसके अनगिनत हाथ हैं, अनगिनत पांव हैं, अनगिनत दिमाग हैं और साथ में है अति आधुनिक तकनीक। इसलिए अब अपना या पराया, मेरा या दूसरे का आतंकवादी कहकर हम इस जंग को नहीं जीत पाएंगे। पता नहीं ये दैत्य किस समय किस तरफ का रुख कर लेगा। इसलिए यदि हम आतंकवाद को जड़ से उखाड़ना चाहते हैं, तो एक ही तरीका है, हम अपने मतभेद भुलाकर आतंकवाद के खिलाफ एकजुट हों, उसका मुकाबला दृढ़ संकल्प से करें और अपने प्रयासों में तेजी लाएं। हमें पुराने समीकरण तोड़ने होंगे, अपनी पसंदगियां नापसंदगियां एक तरफ रखनी होंगी, मोह त्यागने होंगे, एहसानों को भूलना होगा और एक दृढ़ निश्चय के साथ इकट्ठे होकर इस आतंकवाद का सामना करने की रणनीति बनानी होगी। ये मुश्किल काम नहीं है अध्यक्ष महोदय, केवल इच्छा शक्ति की कमी है। ये काम हो सकता है और ये काम हमें करना है। नहीं करेंगे तो हमारी आने वाली संततियां हमें माफ नहीं करेंगी। हाँ, यदि कोई देश इस तरह की रणनीति में शामिल नहीं होना चाहता, तो फिर हम उसे अलग थलग कर दें। अगर कोई देश इस तरह की रणनीति में शामिल नहीं होना चाहता, तो मेरी मांग है कि हम उसे अलग थलग कर दें, क्योंकि दुनिया में ऐसे देश हैं जो बोते भी हैं तो आतंकवाद, उगाते भी हैं तो आतंकवाद, बेचते भी हैं तो आतंकवाद और निर्यात भी करते हैं तो आतंकवाद। आतंकवादियों को पालना कुछ देशों का शौक बन गया है। ऐसे शौकीन देशों की पहचान करके उनकी जवाबदेही सुनिश्चित की जानी चाहिए और ऐसे देशों को भी चिन्हित करना चाहिए जहां संयुक्त राष्ट्र द्वारा प्रतिबंधित आतंकवादी सरेआम जलसे कर रहे हैं, प्रदर्शन निकालते हैं, जहर उगलते हैं और उनके ऊपर कोई कार्रवाई नहीं होती। इसके लिए उन आतंकवादियों के साथ वे देश भी दोषी हैं जो उन्हें ऐसा करने देते हैं। ऐसे देशों की विश्व समुदाय में कोई जगह नहीं होनी चाहिए। अध्यक्ष जी, 21 तारीख को इसी मंच से पाकिस्तान के प्रधानमंत्री ने भारत के संबंध में दो बातें कही, जिनका जवाब देना चाहूंगी। एक तो उन्होंने कहा कि मेरे देश में मानवाधिकार का उल्लंघन हो रहा है। मैं कहना चाहूंगी कि जिनके अपने घर शीशे के हों, उन्हें दूसरों पर पत्थर नहीं फेंकने चाहिए। जरा एक बार बगल में झांक कर देख लें क्या हो रहा है बलूचिस्तान में और वो खुद क्या कर रहे हैं वहां। मैं कह सकती हूं यहां कि आज जो बलूचिस्तान में हो रहा है वो यातनाओं की पराकाष्ठा है। और दूसरी बात उन्होंने कही कि भारत जो शर्तें बातचीत के लिए लगा रहा है वो हमें मंजूर नहीं है। ये समझ नहीं रही कौन सी शर्त, किस शर्त की बात की जा रही है। हमारे शपथ ग्रहण समारोह से पहले जब हमने पाकिस्तान के प्रधानमंत्री को समारोह में आने का न्योता दिया था, आमंत्रण दिया था, तो क्या कोई शर्त रखी थी? मैं स्वयं इस्लामाबाद गई थी और कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव बायलेटरल डायलॉग हमने शुरू किया था इकट्ठे बैठकर, क्या कोई शर्त रखी थी? प्रधानमंत्री मोदी काबुल से दिल्ली आते हुए लाहौर उतर गए थे, कोई शर्त लगाकर गए थे क्या? ये कौन सी शर्तों की बात हो रही है? सच्चाई तो यह है अध्यक्ष जी कि शर्तों के आधार पर नहीं, मित्रता के आधार पर हमने पाकिस्तान के साथ सारे के सारे विवाद सुलझाने की पहल की थी, और मित्रता भी सहजता की तरफ जा रही थी। कभी ईद की शुभकामनाएं, कभी क्रिकेट की शुभकामनाएं, कभी स्वास्थ्य के हाल का कुशलक्षेम। हमने दो बरस में मित्रता का वो पैमाना खड़ा किया जो उससे पहले कभी नहीं था, लेकिन हमें मिला क्या बदले में? पठानकोट, उरी, बहादुर अली। मैं पूछना चाहती हूं, हम शर्तें लगा रहे हैं या आप दूसरी नीयत दिखा रहे हैं? बहादुर अली तो जिंदा सबूत है हमारे पास, जिंदा, कि सीमा पार से आतंकवादी आया है, लिखित में सबूत है हमारे पास उसका। कि मैं एक चीज यहां बता दूं, अगर पाकिस्तान ये समझता है कि इस तरह की हरकतें करके या इस तरह के भड़काऊ बयान देकर वो भारत का कोई हिस्सा हमसे छीन सकता है, तो मैं पूरी दृढ़ता और स्पष्टता के साथ यहां ये कह देना चाहती हूं कि आपका ये मंसूबा कभी कामयाब नहीं होगा। काश्मीर भारत का अभिन्न हिस्सा है, जम्मू काश्मीर भारत का अभिन्न हिस्सा है और अभिन्न हिस्सा रहेगा, इसलिए ये ख्वाब देखना छोड़ दें। अध्यक्ष जी, मैंने प्रारंभ में कहा था कि हमने जो काम किए हैं वो तो हम गिनाएंगे ही, जो नहीं किए वो भी गिनाने चाहिए। मैं ऐसे दो काम गिनाना चाहती हूं। पहला है CCIT यानी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव कन्वेंशन ऑन इंटरनेशनल टेररिज्म। सन 1996 से भारत द्वारा ने प्रस्ताव दिया, 20 साल गुजर गए, आज 2016 में भी हम CCIT निष्कर्ष तक नहीं पहुंचा सके। इसी कारण हम कोई ऐसा अंतर्राष्ट्रीय मानक नहीं बना सके हैं जिसके अंतर्गत आतंकवादियों को सजा दी सके या उनका प्रत्यार्पण हो सके। इसीलिए आप सबसे मेरा अनुरोध है कि ये सभा पूरे दृढ़ निश्चय के साथ जल्द CCIT को पारित करे। दूसरी बात, जैसे आतंकवाद से लड़ने के लिए हमें एक समकालीन नीति चाहिए, उसी प्रकार हमें एक ऐसी संयुक्त राष्ट्र सुरक्षा परिषद भी चाहिए जो आज के वैश्विक परिदृश्य के अनुकूल हो। अधिकांश देशों का मानना है कि संयुक्त राष्ट्र 1945 की वैश्विक परिस्थिति के अनुरूप सिर्फ कुछ ही देशों के हितों की रक्षा ना करे, चाहे वो किसी संस्था की बात हो या मुद्दों की। हमें आज की वास्तविकता और चुनौतियों के अनुसार काम करना होगा। आज सुरक्षा परिषद की स्थायी और अस्थायी दोनों सीटों में विस्तार की आवश्यकता है जिससे सुरक्षा परिषद समकालीन बन सके। मेरा अनुरोध है कि इस आम सभा की इच्छा अनुसार IGN प्रक्रिया, जो टेक्स्ट बेस्ड निगोशिएशन शुरू हुई है, उसको हम जल्दी प्रारंभ करें। यदि ये दोनों चिर प्रतीक्षित कार्य आपके इस कार्यकाल में हो जाते हैं तो मैं कह सकती हूँ कि संयुक्त राष्ट्र सभा का ये 71वां अधिवेशन बहुत ही सार्थक साबित होगा। अध्यक्ष जी, 21वीं सदी पर शुरुआत से ही अशांति और हिंसा का साया रहा है, परंतु मिलजुल कर प्रयास करने से हम इसे मानव सभ्यता के इतिहास में एक स्वर्णिम युग में बदल सकते हैं। लेकिन भविष्य में क्या होगा ये इस बात पर निर्भर करता है कि हम आज क्या करते हैं।
I thank the Minister for External Affairs of India for her statement. I now give the floor to His Excellency Vivian Balakrishnan, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Singapore.
Welcome back. You're watching To The Point. That was Sushma Swaraj, India's foreign minister, making her speech at the United Nations. Still with me, former Foreign Secretary Kamal Sibal, joining me also the Strategic Affairs Editor of the Indian Express, Praveen Swamy, and still with me the Strategic Affairs Editor of the Business Standard, Ajay Shukla. Hopefully, Sanjay Baru will be back with us in a moment's time. Let me ask you first, Kamal Sibal, what you made of that speech.
I think it was an excellent speech, very well crafted, right kind of proportions in terms of addressing international issues and our concerns with regard to terrorism and Pakistan. She prepared the ground for her attack on Pakistan by talking in general terms about the menace of terrorism that is afflicting the world, and that prepared the ground for her attack. But before that, she talked about important issues like climate change and environment and Millennium Development Goals and Sustainable Development Goals and India, what India is doing internally in terms of achieving these goals, Solar Alliance, and the campaigns that the Prime Minister Modi's government has launched internally in India. So there was also there an effort to give an international resonance to some of the programs that the government is pursuing here. Domestically, and on when she talked about terrorism in general, I think she used excellent language, very refined, eloquent language in terms of telling the international community what the dangers were and how the terrorism had become a huge monster, and then very artfully brought in that some countries actually brought in the subject as to who is providing them arms, who is providing them finances, and then without mentioning Pakistan, talking evidently about countries who do not want to be part of the global fight against terrorism and are promoting it, and then brought in Pakistan very well. So I think it was a very effective speech, and I must compliment her for that.
Sanjay Baru, when we were discussing how Mrs. Swaraj should pitch herself and how much time and effort she should put into terror and the subject of Pakistan, you had said that even 5 minutes out of 20 would be too much. You really wanted to do it in passing and move on. Now, I didn't time Mrs. Swaraj, but I certainly had the impression that she spent a fair amount of her speech talking about the bigger subject of terror and within that the specific issue of Pakistan and Pakistani terror, and then within that, the accusations made by Nawaz Sharif about India. Were you happy with the amount of time and effort she spent, or do you think she overdid it?
No, I don't think she overdid it. I think the focus on Pakistan was probably only 1/4 of the total time. There are the larger issues of terrorism on which, of course, she spoke. She spoke about the Middle East, and she spoke about the International Convention on Terrorism. I mean, a lot of issues related to terrorism, but I very specifically focus on Pakistan was, I think, fairly appropriate. And therefore, I agree with Kamal Sibal that I think it was a very fine speech, a balanced speech, and I'm glad she began by focusing on development and the efforts being made in India to deal with the problem of development and poverty reduction, employment generation, so on. I think that is the right tone. I wish she had said a little more on climate change and the global economic situation, but that's fine.
As I heard that speech, Praveen Swamy, the impression in my mind that is perhaps the most lasting of that speech is the way she countered the point made by Nawaz Sharif that India had imposed conditions, preconditions to talks. And she went out of her way to say that there were no preconditions imposed when Nawaz was invited for Mr. Modi's oath-taking, no preconditions involved when she went for the Heart of Asia conference in Islamabad, no preconditions involved when Mr. Modi journeyed to Pakistan in Christmas last year. And she even then went out of her way to say that, you know, no preconditions were involved when Eid greetings are exchanged or when we wish success to Pakistan's cricket team. Was she effective in making her point, or did she go into so much detail that did she perhaps inadvertently convey to the audience that this is rankled with India?
I was holding my breath, as you know, right through that speech, wishing that she wouldn't say a word about this, given that we had a very able diplomatic defense at what I thought was the appropriate level a few days ago. I really felt that it felt a little bit like a Hindi film lament, if you like, that I'm such a nice guy. I wanted to be friends with you. I gave you my chocolate, I shared my lunch, and you are still so mean to me and you pull my pigtails. It did not seem to me to have the robustness that I would have liked from a speech and on an occasion as important as this. It seemed to me that this was an opportunity to say serious things about what India would like to see done. India had a while ago flagged its concerns about the fact, for example, that the 1267 Committee on Sanctions isn't working transparently. It would have been great to hear the External Affairs Minister say, you know, this is what India wants done about this. This is what we want done about the fact that the new Taliban chief is roaming around with no sanctions to his name. This is what India wants done about the fact that people the UN has sanctioned, like Hafiz Saeed, are roaming around with complicity from states like Pakistan. An agenda for action, if you like, rather than a lament. This was too much whining for me, not enough substance. I have to say, I thought she was fantastic on things like climate change. I thought she was fantastic on the economy. But on the subject of terror, not enough substance there, too much complaining.
Ajay Shukla, there's a very interesting critique that you've just heard from Praveen Swamy, that the manner, tone in which she brought up this business of preconditions sounded like a lament. It didn't have the robustness, and that there were other critical issues to do with terror, like the non-implementation of 1267, the fact that the new Taliban head is walking around quite freely, although she did touch upon that en passant. But she didn't bring up directly with the UN General Assembly the fact that attempts that were made to direct attention on Masood Azhar, for instance, had failed, and that involves the failure of the UN itself. Do you agree with Praveen's basic critique that some of the tone was wrong, some of the detail was a little flippant and unnecessary, and some big issues like the UN Security Council failing to handle Masood Azhar should have been brought up but weren't?
Karan, I think that any assessment of Sushma Swaraj's speech has to take into account the fact that she was addressing an audience at the UN General Assembly and at the same time addressing an audience in India. This was, as I mentioned earlier, coming off the back of the Uri attack, coming off the back of a commitment that we are going for Pakistan, we are going to isolate Pakistan on the international arena. So this speech was perfectly in consonance with that. It's a little difficult to make a moral judgment or a strategic assessment of a speech by delinking it from the political context in which it's made. So I think given the political context, Sushma Swaraj was in line with what she had set out to do, what brief she was carrying from the government of India. Sushma Swaraj is emerging as a very able Rottweiler of the government. She was, for example, when she was defending the government's decision to cancel the National Security Advisor's speech, she was extremely able. She really put forward the government's viewpoint very well. This was last year. And this time again at the UN Security Council, I think that she had a strategic aim. And that strategic aim was to paint India as this responsible sort of large power that was fulfilling international commitments, both in terms of the global development agenda, in terms of the Paris Accords, and at the same time there was this Pakistan, which was fit to be an international pariah. So I think that she had a larger game plan. She executed the execution of Pakistan, if I may put it that way. She put Pakistan to the sword fairly ably. And while Praveen does have a certain point over there that maybe she labored the point a little bit too much, but given the political context in which she was speaking, I'm not surprised.
Constable, I want to take up a little further with you, because you're a former foreign secretary, the point that Praveen made, that this was an opportunity when she's speaking to the UN General Assembly to raise the fact that the UN Security Council, at least twice in the last year, for reasons of international politics between the P5 and China's support for Pakistan, failed to take up on two issues that India has raised. One, the Masood Azhar issue, that he should have been proscribed and he hasn't been. And secondly, earlier, if you recall, the fact that India had complained to the P5 and the UN Security Council about Zakir Rahman Lakhvi being granted bail and Pakistan not doing anything about it. And in both those instances, China actually intervened and exercised their effective veto. Do you think that should have come up? Because that is a clear UN issue, and it would have pointed out to the General Assembly that on a critical subject, the Security Council doesn't function as it should.
Well, indirectly, she brought in this question because she talked about the reforming the UN Security Council that it no longer reflected the distribution of power in the world.
Towards very the end, indirectly.
She made that point quite effectively. Now, with regard to what you said about, she measured two things, the Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism and reformed the UN Security Council. On both these issues, India has been very active and has been pushing for both these reforms and legislation, and therefore it was right for her to emphasize this. But with regard to what you said, you know, in the Security Council, everybody was with us on the issue of Lakhvi and Masood Azhar. Only China opposed it. Now, you had to make a judgment whether if you were going to pinpoint this particular setback that we received in the UN Security Council, do we want to attack China in this forum? Because this is what it would have amounted to. And in the context of a fight against terrorism and putting Pakistan on the mat and asking for Pakistan's isolation, and bringing home to the international community how the terrorists were roaming around in Pakistan, I think the fact that we could not declare these two people as international terrorists or have Pakistan explain how they violated the 1267, to my mind, was relatively a very minor affair. And there was no need really to focus on it. It was a matter of detail. It was a larger picture that was far more important. The second thing that struck me is that her speech received 4 or 5 times applause from the audience. That surprised me because I could hear that it can't simply be the Indian delegation. So the points that she was making on terrorism were received very well by the people who were listening, by countries who were listening. And that, to my mind, is quite an achievement.
Sanjay Baru, let's move beyond terror and Kashmir to the other aspects and subjects that Mrs. Swaraj raised. She spoke about poverty, climate change, the International Day of Yoga, energy, as well as the expansion of the United Nations Security Council. What did you make of those bits?
I think these are all the key issues. I mean, before her speech, when I was speaking on this program, I did say to you that, you know, we are aspiring members of the UN Security Council. We have larger concerns. Terrorism is one of them, or Pakistan is one of them. But there are so many of these other concerns and so many other roles we have played. And I think the fact that she flagged each one of them went along with what I would have liked her to do. So I think each of those, and the fact that on October 2nd, on Gandhi Jayanti Day, we are going to sign the Convention on Climate Change, I think was important, and she flagged that as well. Plus the fact that the Indian Parliament now discusses the Millennium Development Goals and a commitment to sustainable development. You know, these are all the important issues for a UN General Assembly audience. They would have got bored if we had gone on and on only about Pakistan. Secondly, I would just like to make the point that, you know, on the whole issue of Pakistan and terror, I think it's important to understand that the style she adopted was one of suggesting to the international community that, look, I mean, we are the good guys. And it's important to make that point. You know, it's not, I wouldn't use the word whining to describe that. I think the image of this government internationally was one of being a very kind of jingoistic, hardline political party that was trying to be, tough with its neighbors. But the fact is that this good neighborly policy that Prime Minister Modi adopted from day one and improved relations with Bangladesh, with Sri Lanka, with Nepal, you know, with other countries. And I think, therefore, to make the point that, look, this is the only problem child, was a good point.
Prithami, this was a speech that was being delivered at the United Nations. It was meant for the world. Obviously, the Kashmir bits and the terror bits were meant for an audience at home. But Mrs. Swaraj really had important messages that India wants the world to hear. She speaks fluent English, but she chose to speak in Hindi. On this occasion, would she have been better advised to deliver this in English so that it was more accessible to the audience and more easy for them to follow immediately? Translations, no matter how good, are not the best way of hearing a speech.
Absolutely, and that translation which you heard was not an inspired one. I mean, she's a fabulous speaker. She brings energy to everything she says. I think so. I think there was an element of national pride, if you like, being projected there. she was making a point for her audience at home, that, you know, she's not embarrassed to speak in Hindi. But I think sometimes with an international audience, this is misplaced. Often the power of a speech lies in your ability to phrase, to give emphasis to particular passages. And translators are often, you know, while they're great at delivering the words of a particular speech, succeed in killing its message. I wish she'd pick English there.
Ajay Shukla, as I'm reminded of what you wrote in your paper, The Business Standard, this morning. In a sense, you were echoing what Praveen wrote in his paper, The Indian Express. Yesterday, you pointed out that Mr. Modi's Saturday speech in Kozhikode marked a significant shift away from the earlier perception that he was seriously considering some sort of military response to Uri towards a more diplomatic response or a contest in terms of development. Was that, in a sense, further underlined and enhanced by the nature of the speech you heard from Mrs. Swaraj today, that India is going to seek to isolate Pakistan, but military response is now no longer being considered? I know that she may not have clearly mentioned it at the UN, but the nature of her speech, does it underline and take further the impression you got from the Prime Minister over the weekend?
Oh, yes, that's what I had mentioned earlier in the program, that she had gone there with a clear agenda. She was going to isolate Pakistan, just as Mr. Modi had promised he would at Kozhikode. Earlier, in fact, Rajnath Singh had also mentioned the same thing. So this is now clearly going to be the game plan of the government of India in various international forums, in engagements between India and Pakistan in the international domain. And to that extent, I think she was very much in line. There was no question of actually mentioning the possibility of armed retaliation for the UD attack. That is purely a bilateral and internal to government decision. But certainly the way that she went after Pakistan, the signal would have gone out to the BJP's domestic constituency in India that we are delivering on our commitment to isolate Pakistan in the international arena.
Sanjay Baru, I know I'm going to lose you very quickly, so let me ask you a quick question before you go. Do you also share the impression that was first mentioned by Praveen Swamy in his article in The Express yesterday, today by Ajay Shukla in The Business Standard, that after the initial militaristic tones of the tweets we heard last weekend, particularly from Ram Madhav, but also from the Prime Minister who talked about punishing, we are now coming back to the traditional response of what's called strategic restraint?
I won't hazard a guess at the moment. I think different elements of the government and the party speak in different voices to address different constituencies. It is silly for us to expect all of them to speak in the same language. The Prime Minister is, at the end of the day, the Prime Minister of the country. Ram Madhav is General Secretary of his party. So therefore, you know, that if there is a difference in the tone between the two, I wouldn't, you know, think there's confusion. I would say, why is it that one tone is being adopted here and another tone there? On this whole business of strategic restraint or, you know, holding back, I would, you know, wait to come to a conclusion. You know, I don't think you should expect Mr. Modi to stand up and declare his strategy, to tell what he wants to do. So at each point, I would analyze a Prime Minister's intervention on the basis of the available facts.
Okay.
You know, and political leaders can change what they say from day to day. That is not inconsistency. That would well be part of a strategy.
Praveen Swamy, let's for a moment focus on the intention that the government has, which at some level they've even made public, to isolate Pakistan. How easy is it going to be? Because one of the things I've noticed in the last few days is that Gulbuddin Hekmatyar has been welcomed back by the regime in Afghanistan.
The butcher of Kabul.
Absolutely. I mean, and if anything else, Gulbuddin Hekmatyar has been seeking sanctuary and got it in Pakistan. He's a lot closer to Pakistan than he is to us. His rehabilitation in Afghanistan suggests that the Afghan government is not necessarily isolating Pakistan, but finding through their proxy a certain room for the man. And this man was responsible for some of the worst killings, and he's no friend of ours. So are there contradictions in the air that concern you when you say this target and goal of isolating Pakistan is not going to be easy to fulfill, and some of the indications are that far from succeeding, the Afghan government is doing contradictory things.
Look, frankly, I have no idea what the government means when it says we're going to isolate Pakistan. Let's even assume, for the sake of argument, that Afghanistan and Bangladesh go along with India and withdraw their ambassadors and never talk to Pakistan again, for the sake of argument. The reality is that Afghanistan and Bangladesh are not the world. And when it comes to the world, no country of any significant size or importance is going to go along with some Indian plan of putting a nuclear armed state in a box and refusing to talk to them or taking actions which may make them more unstable, more unpredictable, that will deny big powers any influence they might currently have over their actions. We see Russia, as we speak, exercising with their military. The United States continues, despite its deep problems with Pakistan and Pakistani policy, to have a robust economic and military relationship with Pakistan. There's various kinds of pressure exerted, but that doesn't mean they're going to, shut the door and walk away. The European Union, again, has a variety of relationships. Various European states have those relationships. The Saudis have warmed to us, but they continue to have a robust relationship. So does Iran. Whether we like it or not, Pakistan is one of the world's major military powers. It is a nuclear weapon state, de facto. And painful as this reality is, we have to live with it and work with it. It is not going to go away.
Kamal Sibal, do you want to respond to that rather cogent argument you just heard from Praveen Swamy that, A, what isolating Pakistan is or amounts to is not defined. It's a vague concept left hanging in the air. But secondly, it might be a bit dangerous to try and put into a box, as he said, a nuclear weapon state and make it more unstable, and to cut it off and put it into a corner where its unpredictable responses become more difficult to handle. And therefore, not only is this concept of isolating Pakistan vague and undefined, but it could be potentially dangerous to attempt because it might make Pakistan a worse sort of opponent. How do you want to respond to that?
Two things. One about Gulmat Hikmatyar. I think one need to clarify that Hikmatyar relations with Pakistan are very poor indeed. And he has already built bridges with the Afghan government long ago. And many of his ministers, many of the members of his party are ministers in the present government. He has very good relations with Iran. So the fact that he has been accommodated within the power structure actually has no significance in terms of the Taliban or the Pakistan. But having said that, I would agree that if the idea of isolating Pakistan is that the countries of the world ostracize Pakistan, that will not happen for all the reasons that Praveen Swamy mentioned, and they are very relevant. But if the idea is to destroy Pakistan's credibility more and more, because Pakistan claims that it's a victim of terrorism itself, that it is in the forefront of the fight against international terrorism, since they are fighting the terrorists on their western frontier, and totally refuses to acknowledge that they have any hand in promoting terrorism anywhere, contrary to evidence that is available. I think if the idea is simply to destroy its credibility, expose it more and more, make the international community aware by launching a potent campaign on this issue, that Pakistan actually is becoming more and more a problem. I think if that is the objective, we could succeed partially in achieving that objective, though Pakistan will maintain good relations with the Gulf countries. Even in our region, countries like Sri Lanka and Nepal will not isolate Pakistan. And China, of course, will never allow Pakistan to be isolated because they are going in a different direction altogether.
Absolutely,
where
Mr.
they
Sibal.
Are, in fact, geopolitically and economically putting in more effort in terms of strengthening the relations with Pakistan.
All right, I think that's a very clear answer, that depending upon what the objective is when you talk about isolating Pakistan, you might either not succeed at all, or you might only succeed, as Kamal Sibal says, partially, but not necessarily fully. Let's leave it there. My thanks to all my guests for joining me. There we end this particular episode of To The Point. Goodbye. Goodbye.